Hello, and welcome to the Keith Qualvitt Show. I'm your host, Keith Young. I want to thank folks for viewing in last month when we had our show on domestic violence. I really appreciate all participants that came on. And I want to give a big shout out to Ms. Robin Porter, who was talking about legislation and law that was going to be passed about domestic violence folks that had restraining orders on them or not able to carry firearms now. And that bill has been passed. So Robin, I just want to make sure I give a good shout out to you and say thank you so much. Brenda, we really appreciate you coming on and sharing your story. You folks watched that show all last month. I had some really, really good feedback on it. Let's keep on educating the community on this particular topic. Tonight, we're going to educate you a whole lot. What we have on, who we have on the show tonight, the topic is on deafness. We're going to have translators here, and we're going to show our translators and our interpreters, I'm sorry. They're going to correct me a lot on this show, because this is new ground for me, new territory for me. On tonight's show, we have some big wigs. I got to admit, we have some very big wigs. We have Mr. Jeffrey Braven from the American School of Deaf. We also have Ms. Sandra Nzinga, I believe. And we also have Ms. Barbara Kaysen. I hope I pronounced that correctly. In the show, we have interpreter, and the interpreter, you'll see, will be interpreting what I'm saying for the viewing audience, for those folks who are trying to capture a new audience now. I don't know if I'm going to be politically correct in some of the things that I say, I'm calling him Jeff. He's a pretty cool guy, Jeff, to slap me around every now and then if I'm saying something wrong. Sometimes, you know, you just don't know, and that's why we're having this show, to educate, inform, and empower the viewing audience. So, without further ado, I want to thank our distinguished guest for being on tonight. Jeff, if you want to just wave hello to the viewing audience, we'd appreciate that.
I'm happy and able to be here.
Okay. This is really, really new for me. So, all right, my bad. I have an interpreter, as you see. You're going to hear a voice for Jeff. This interpreter is going to be sharing what Jeff is saying, and along with the rest of the set, they're going to be bouncing back and forth. So I have to say, on my P's and Q's, this is new for me, and I love the fact that I'm educating myself. They're going to be educating me as well tonight on the show. So let's do this one more time. Let's go, and we have Jeff on the set. We also have Sandra, and we have Barbara. And thank you all for being on the set tonight. We're going to talk about deaf, the deaf community, new territory. And it's very, very interesting. So I want to thank you very much, Jeff. Thank you so much.
Thank
really
you.
Appreciate it. Can you please explain to me, viewing audience, what is deaf?
It's a good question. First of all, I would like to thank you for having us here this evening. It's our opportunity to educate people, as you said. And we don't get this opportunity often because deaf people really, we're a small population. I call us an invisible disability because if you, you know, see a deaf person on the street, they look just like anybody else, you wouldn't know they were deaf. There's about 40 million deaf people in America. We're just basically normal people. We just can't hear. And for a variety of reasons. Some people are born deaf. Some people are born hearing and then later lose their hearing. Mm-hmm. Some people at a very late age lose their hearing. During the rubella times, people who got rubella often their children were deaf or they became deaf themselves. That was a large population. For me, my family is deaf, my parents are deaf, my brothers and sisters are deaf, my grandmother's deaf, and my grandfather, and my great-grandmother and grandfather. So for me, it's genetic. I'm fourth generation deaf. For other people, that reason is different. 95% of deaf children are born to hearing families. So our challenge is to continue to educate these people. They have a deaf child. They don't know what to do with this deaf child. How can they raise them to fit into the world? I mean, we're good examples of what deaf people can do. So.
Wow. Shani, thank you. Thank you. And I'm going to get to the other guests real quick, but, you know, I have lots of notes here, Jeff, the panel, but I'm not going to get to all of them. You said something very interesting. Your whole family is deaf.
Yes.
Very interesting. Well, I would think that I'm like, wow, but that's nothing to you. That's family.
The advantage for me, because my family is deaf, when I was born, my very first communication was through American Sign Language. So I had access to communication and language from birth. Kind of really didn't know what the hearing world existed until much later in my life. I had my communication. Compared to other children who are deaf and born to hearing families, they have no access to communication unless the parents realize that the child is deaf at an early age and learn sign language. So parents get different information. They feel lost when they have a deaf child and they don't know what's best for that child. So communication delay for many children, deaf children, is very common. So every day, as an educator and as community people, as Sandy and Barbara are, we go out and educate people in the community. We introduce them to deafness because there's nothing wrong with being deaf. I mean, I have to thank technology as well, because that's really changed so much over the years. Our barriers that we used to have because of being deaf, no access to television, to phones, etc. Now with technology, almost all TV programs are captioned. We have full access. We have smartphones. We have email. If I were to send you an email, you wouldn't know I was deaf when you read it until you met me, and then you'd be like, oh, you're deaf. Or what happens many times is, let me tell you, I send you an email, and then you call me. And I answer the phone, but what you hear is a woman's voice. This is Jeff. Is this Jeff? Or people misunderstand, oh, I'm supposed to talk with Jess, maybe, because they hear a woman's voice. Because I have a woman interpreter with me all the time. And that's when people are sort of taken aback and was like, oh, and then I tell them I'm a deaf individual speaking through a sign language interpreter, which is the reason you're a woman's voice. And then the problem goes away. So that's one of the benefits of educating people.
Fault me, because I didn't know you were deaf, Jeff. When I got emails from you, we're going back and forth. Well, not until I saw you on the news, Channel 8 News, and we were talking about Dancing with the Stars, and I said, hey, that guy's going to be on my show. So I didn't know. I didn't know. So thank you for coming on the show, and thank you so much. We're going to be talking a lot to you, Jeff, so I really appreciate you coming on the show.
Thank you.
Sandra, Vice President at the American School of Dance, Deaf?
No, I'm the President of the Connecticut Association of the Deaf.
Okay. And what exactly do you do there? What is your role?
Well, CAD is a nonprofit advocate organization, and we're watching out for making sure that people's rights are not being violated. We help to protect those rights, and we try to make sure that in situations where their rights are being denied, we will help to fight for them in the legislature and so forth, just to make sure that they have, you know, all accessibility.
Great. And I'm going to be getting back to you again. Jeff?
I'd like to add to what she said. The Connecticut Association of the Deaf is a state association agency under a national association, which is the National Association of the Deaf, which is based in Washington, D.C. So every state has their own association, but they're under the umbrella of the National Association of the Deaf. They work on legislation, discrimination issues against deaf individuals, and they try to help people, deaf people, become leaders and speak out for themselves.
Great.
And Sandy has done a great job in the past few years really representing the deaf and hard of hearing people in Connecticut.
Great.
Thank you.
Great.
CAD was founded in 1939, and at that time the legislature was trying to pass legislation because they were denying people the right to drive. We were not allowed to get, you know, driver's license.
Right.
So we banded together and we said, oh, wait a minute, we can drive, why can't we? And we were able to, you know, overpower that legislation, and we were able to get the license.
And we were the first state to do this. In Connecticut, it happened right here, the first
outstanding.
State.
Outstanding.
Yes, we have many firsts here in Connecticut.
Lots of firsts in Connecticut. First to have the license, first school for the deaf in America. I need to brag a little bit, if that's okay, about that.
Please.
We created the first commission on the deaf and hard of hearing in the state of Connecticut as well. And we have had lots of firsts here to help people. Unfortunately, the commission on the deaf and hard of hearing closed its doors a few years ago because of state funding. But we're not giving up. We will continue to fight because we have a person, we need a person there to speak for the deaf and hard of hearing people in Connecticut.
And I'm going to brag a little bit too, Jeff. You're the first to come on my show, too, so.
Awesome.
That's what's up.
Yeah.
Barbara, how are you?
I'm very fine, thank you. I would like to thank you for letting us join you tonight. I am the vice president of the Connecticut Association of the Deaf, and I'm on the board of directors for the American School for the Deaf, and I'm also the chairperson for ASD's 200th bicentennial celebration. So keeps me going full time, even though I retired from the state last year after working for 28 years. I was a vocational rehabilitation counselor, and I worked with people who had, you know, various disabilities, including deaf and hard of hearing, but I had a general caseload. But my primary responsibility was helping them to find employment and help to advocate and help train them and make sure that they were getting the appropriate accommodations to be successful on the job. Even though I retired, I am still wearing many different hats, and it's keeping me very busy today.
Great, great. Thank you so much for coming on. Thank you all for coming on. I want to thank our interpreters for coming on as well. We have Mary Sue, and we have JK that's on tonight interpreting, so we really appreciate it. You see Mary Sue on camera here. JK, she's chilling over on the side there. She is the voice for Jeffrey, and we really appreciate it. All right. But I have a lot of questions. You know, what... Well, first of all, I want to say that I'm at a disadvantage because when I want to jump in, like I, as I usually do, I'm always jumping into a conversation, cutting people off.
Come on.
I don't know sign language,
do
so
it.
I can't.
You can. The interpreters will just cut us off for you. They'll let you jump in. If I'm signing,
right?
You can talk. The interpreter will just cut me right off. And you
can go
ahead
good.
And talk. Just have a normal conversation like you would do on any of your shows.
Okay, good enough, good enough, good enough. And you notice, you know, every now and then you'll see me turn off to the side because I hear a voice. I'm so used to hearing a voice that it's innate with me that that's the first thing I'm going to do. So viewing audience, you know, I apologize, but this is new, and I love it. It's new for you as well, so please watch. And if you know of a family member who may be deaf or folks in school or anything like that, the show's going to, you know, repeat shows come on throughout the week. You know when it is, and if you don't know, make sure you hit me up on Facebook or hit me up on my email, thekeithqualitieshow@gmail.com. I'll get the information to you. But as we get ready to get into some information, I don't think that there's too much hidden information for the deaf community. How large is the deaf community in, if you know, New Haven, Hamden, West Haven area? I mean, I know we said 40 million across, the United States, but is it a big population here locally?
The problem with the state, in the past, the state did a good job of tracking all the deaf and hard of hearing individuals in the state, but since the commission folded, the tracking folded as well. I would say in Connecticut, 2,000 to 3,000 deaf people in the state of Connecticut. In New Haven, I mean, it's a pretty big city. What's the population of New Haven?
Oh, I don't know, Jeff. I don't know. I don't know.
I would say close to maybe 1,000, a little bit less than 1,000 would live in the New Haven area. Probably close to 300 deaf and hard of hearing students in the school system in New Haven, mm-hmm. in the area.
If I could, when the commission was in existence, if I remember correctly, they figured out the numbers were at 28,000 deaf, hard of hearing people and people who had a hearing loss.
Okay. Right, with a hearing loss.
Right, and that was the entire state of Connecticut. So those numbers, I mean, approximately 28,000 way back when the commission was established. Now that could be someone who has a hearing loss in one ear, both ears, but we're talking about 1974, okay. around that time. So I'm not sure how those numbers track now.
Mm-hmm. But hearing loss could mean elderly people who have lost their hearing at a later age, and that counts. And they probably don't identify themselves as deaf persons as we do, but the numbers would vary depending on who you're really focusing on.
Right, right, right. Very interesting, very interesting. Talk to me about some of the laws, legislative, that's been going on. You know, what have been some of the laws that have been passed that you're very proud of? So folks get out there can know what the fight has been. And I mean, this is like a civil rights movement. I mean,
it is. There's been several legislations passed, but the most recent one was 2 years ago when they passed the Deaf Child Bill of Rights.
Okay.
The reason for that is there's so many children in the state of Connecticut in public schools or even at the American School for the Deaf. And the LEAs, the local education agency peoples, host PPT meetings for students. And often the discussion is about what course is best for the student. But they're basing it based on what they can do rather than the child. So we had the Child Bill of Rights, and it included a language communication plan. So it forces during that PPD meeting to take a look at the individual child and what the best language and communication for that child would be, and which educational environment is best for that child, and that determines the appropriate placement for the student. And we were very proud of having that law passed. Mm-hmm. But what we're still not happy about is even though the bill passed and we have the language communication plan document, the school districts, the LEAs don't use it. It's not enforced. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, they just make decisions without really taking a look at the individual child. Mm-hmm. So we're working with the legislator now. This year it's a short session, as you know. So with a short session, there's really not much you can do with the legislature. Their focus, of course, is on the budget. So next year with the long session, I'm hoping to approach the legislation again and talk about that bill and why it needs to be enforced more than it is, and make sure that every deaf and hard of hearing child gets the appropriate access to the education and language in the state of Connecticut. Mm-hmm. Because I can tell you based on experience, my own educational history, the average age of a student that comes to our school is between the age 12 and 14.
Wow.
And people ask me why that is. Mm-hmm. Because the local school districts prefer to try and serve the student in district, which I do understand. But are they the experts? Are they the people with the knowledge? I mean, they're trying, that's okay, but they try until they get to the point where they realize they can't do anything more. Oh, we have the American School for the Deaf. We'll place them there and let them do their magic.
But it's a no-brainer, though. It's a no-brainer. Why would they try to do it themselves? I mean, up to age 12, instead of tapping into a resource such as rich as yours and resources that are out there, why wouldn't they? I mean, age 12, what happens to the self-esteem of that child? What happens to the spirit of that child? What happens to all of those, the socialization and all of that good old stuff? Why would the Board of Education and places wait that long, Jeff?
I knew more spokespeople like you, people who really get it from the very first time. I'm extremely impressed.
Are you sure you're looking just for a good looking person, Jeff? I like this guy.
Language acquisition happens from birth to the age of 8.
Okay.
That's the prime time for language acquisition. Children, that's when they learn most of their language. So what I always say, send them to us first. Mm-hmm. So we can provide the language and visual access and everything that they need. Then if they thrive and do well, they can stay with us for social, emotional, and physical needs. Mm-hmm. Or if they would like to go to a public school, that's fine. I'm a good example of that. I was born to a deaf family. I had sign language from birth. I went to a school for the deaf until I was in ninth grade. And then I realized, you know, I had everything I need, but I wasn't really satisfied. I wanted to know what public school was like, so I went to a public school for the last 3 years of my high school. I had my language foundation. I was functioning just fine. I was able to handle this and thrive in a public school. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I'm feeling that I need to give back to the children because of the education I had. And to see many children out there struggling, mm-hmm. or not able to have the same access to language and education that I had, I think what I'm doing now is going out and educating people about what's best for each child. It's very frustrating, mm-hmm. though.
I bet it is. I bet it is. Sandra, can you talk to me about some of the challenges? I'm going to talk about the accomplishments. You know, that's going to be our plateau going towards the end of the show. But can you please talk to me about some of the challenges that you face at your position and where you're at?
Well, some of the challenges that we're seeing now is that deaf people have become much more separated from each other. We're trying to unite people to fight together, and very often they're isolated. And some of the issues that, you know, because first of all, we're a small community to begin with. Very small community to begin with. And so trying to bring people together to talk about, you know, the common issues such as accessibility, trying to get them to come with us to go to a rally or to go to the legislature has been a real challenge. Mm-hmm. And so yes, we're working, you know, trying to work together and so that we're all going to benefit by working together. That's an issue that we're facing.
I need to give you a little historical background here.
Please.
In my younger days, the deaf community, as I said, they had no access to technology, to information. I mean, you know, mail would take 2 to 5 days to get to your home. So communication was mm-hmm. extremely delayed. No captioning. You had to guess what they were saying on the news. I mean, the only thing we were able to understand really was the weather, because you'd see a picture of the sun right. or a picture mm-hmm. of the rain. But right. anything else, we were just guessing. Right. And that was a guessing game for us. We had deaf clubs all over the United States.
Deaf clubs?
And Connecticut. Yes, deaf clubs. My uncle was the bartender at my deaf club. And so I used to go to the deaf club, and he was bartending. You know, I would be playing with the kids. He'd be bartending for the old guys. That was my social time with the community. We would get together because we had no other way to get in touch with one another. I mean, it was our universe. We'd find out about the news because somebody read it in the newspaper. They would explain. So that was our education outside of school as well. Mm-hmm. But as technology improved, the clubs started to dissipate. People no longer had to get together face-to-face because they could text. They could use their smartphones. There was emails, like she was talking about. It's harder now to get people to come together physically.
If I could interject, I'd like to mention that years ago, the residential schools, such as American School for the Deaf, had a large group of students who were enrolled. We're talking 500-600 students. I mean, and we're talking about all the schools across the country. And so we had peers who were like us. And now we see those enrollments, you know, declining because mainstreaming became the focus. Many of those mainstream schools, those students are not aware of the resources in the community, and the schools are not. We had that information at the School for the Deaf. We learned from each other. We were able to share that with each other. And, you know, most of the information we got was from our teachers, from our staff. Those were our role models. I mean, we looked up to them. But now when you look at the students who are in the mainstream, where are their role models? Where do they get information about those resources? Unless they are somehow connected to someone in the deaf community, either, you know, through, you know, technology, video phones, or something like that. But it's a lot more work for them. They have to reach out a lot more. And you have to really get the information to them about what's available. I mean, we're always there if there's an emergency. I mean, yeah, they'll definitely come together in an emergency, but everything is a work in progress, and it's a lot of work. So the challenges that we're facing, that's probably the primary one. Would you agree?
Go back to education.
Okay.
She said schools for the DAF are losing students because of mainstreaming. Mm-hmm. And these bills were passed by people that had no connection with deaf persons or people who don't understand deafness. Mm-hmm. And they passed them because they felt that we're like special education students. Special education people are advocating for inclusion, mainstreaming. They want, you know, their child close to home. You know, they have other needs, so they should just be in a normal school setting and let them learn from peers. And that concept is great, and I totally get it. But for a deaf student, their language is different. Their communication needs are different. So to put them with peers without any access to communication, they will drown. But it's because of those laws that's preventing the students from coming to schools such as the American School for the Deaf. So what we do is we fight and we try to educate people about language and communication access for all children and make sure they're getting what they need. And the best place really is the School for the Deaf. Also, there are other factors. There are other schools who advocate for what we call an oral program.
Right. I read that in my notes. Right.
I'm not opposed to oral programs, but I could tell you from my experience and what I've seen as an educator for many years, oral programs do succeed if the child has language or if the parents are very involved. Either one of those two factors or both. If the parents are not involved, the child will lose out on access to communication with their own parents.
Let me jump in here real quick, Jeff. So that's part of my deal with parenting and parenthood. Parents nowadays are kind of slacking off of being parents, especially in the inner cities. I'll keep it real. Whether it's lack of education, whether it's lack of stronger family, your generations and everything like that. So the parents themselves are falling off. They're not educated themselves. So how do you save those children? I mean, what is your outreach like? You know, we have DCF, you know, we have social services. Are you guys connected with those kind of things for children as well? I mean, when you talk about children's rights.
Another thing about parents. Today, parents, because of economy, they work two or three jobs. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it's not really the parents' fault, it's society's fault. Mm-hmm. We've created this issue for these people, so parents need to work all these jobs. How can they really pay full attention to their child? They arrive home exhausted often. And for a normal hearing child, maybe that's okay, but a deaf child is more work.
Right.
They have to learn to communicate, sign, whatever. I mean, it's impossible for these parents. So those children really lose out. Or they place them in a school and, you know, fix my child, you figure out what to do with my child, and they expect a school to take the responsibility. So public schools are doing a lot of great things often. If they had a large number of students, 30, 40, 50 students, they could probably hire a few teachers to educate the children. And that would be better than nothing, so to speak. They would have some language and communication access. But in this state and many other states where they're isolated, there's just one here and there, they have no access, no
right.
social life, no cognitive stimulation,
right.
physical needs. They're lost. So what we do with outreach, we talk about the needs for these children. Yes, there is a price tag associated with it. Mm-hmm. So some towns are like, oh, but if I send them to the school, I have to pay. And yes, there is a price tag associated. But you have to think long term. If you place them there now, they get the appropriate language and educational foundation, they're going to be productive citizens. They'll give back to society. They'll be tax-paying citizens. If not, you know, if they get lost in the school system, they grow up, they may never work, they may never have a really good life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they may end up in a group home or a mental hospital. That happens often out there. They can't be productive tax-paying citizen.
Right.
So the state ends up ultimately paying more,
right.
and it should be the other
right.
way around.
Right, right.
So parent involvement is crucial. Even though at the American School for the Deaf we have many parents involved who are involved, there are many that are not. And our job is to work with those families and bring them in, and we provide transportation for families to literally bring them to school, to educate them, to teach them sign language at no cost to them. Everything is free at our school, and you can come and learn sign language if you'd like to at the American School for the Deaf.
I'm going to, as a side note, you know, nothing to do with the show, but, you know, after speaking with Ms. Mary Good and reading up on the show, doing a little bit of research, as I mentioned off on the set, you know, I'm doing bottle now with my granddaughter, you know, and I'm teaching her. Jeff told me, you know, did I know where that sign language came from? And it's milking the cow. So I got what, you know, it's very interesting, but I want to develop that kind of communication with my granddaughter, you know, with my granddaughters, you know, and even my grandson who's 6 years old. English has a second language. Should that include sign language in schools? We do Spanish, we do French, we got all different kinds, you know, because of different, you know, migration going on, everything. So why not? And have you advocated, have you thought about that? Is that something that's been in some other state someplace, English has a second language?
Yes, we actually passed legislation here in Connecticut that American Sign Language should be considered a world language. That was a few years ago. That we wanted to make sure that it used to be considered language arts, okay. But we're saying no, we want them to be getting this so that they can get the credit for it. And so no matter if it's French or Spanish, it should be the same way. So we've been able to do that because we are considered the third most used language in the United States.
It's interesting. When the state passed ASL as a world language this year, there were 4 high schools that were offering ASL as a foreign language, so to speak. Next year, there are going to be 10 high schools in the state who will be offering ASL. So it's growing.
Okay.
I want to go back to the bilingualism. ASD has embraced a bilingual approach. We teach our students using American Sign Language and English, like we're doing right now. And English through writing and reading and spoken language, spoken and listening as well. Research has proven that bilingual children learn faster, their cognitive abilities develop faster, the same as hearing children who go to a bilingual school. Bilingual children outperform monolingual children. So we have to do the same thing. That's the reason we decided to change our approach to a bilingual approach so we can educate them using ASL, provide them a foundation of language, and then teach them how to move to English, reading, writing, and the ability to speak if they have it, and listening. Because if you don't have language, you cannot learn to speak.
Right.
So you must have language to be able to speak. So using ASL is the foundation. I mean, look at the hearing babies that's going on. Parents are teaching hearing babies sign language. Why? Because you pick up sign before you speak. At young as 6 months of age, you can start to sign. Speaking starts at 12. You can start language acquisition at birth, like milk. Daddy, mommy. I mean, the child's not going to sign it clearly like an adult. They'll have a baby sign language. So, but by the time they're ready to speak, they already have a language foundation. That child will thrive.
Yes.
So sign language, I mean, the hearing parents are teaching hearing children to sign. But deaf children, it's much harder. The parents aren't involved. Parents feel it's hard for them to learn. Because now ASL is spreading, that means more and more people are going to know, and they're going to be parents someday, so hopefully one day they will be teaching their children. But, I mean, that's, you know, one of the things we do. We try to promote awareness.
Right.
I'd like to add to what Jeff said. I think the biggest challenge that we face is the medical field. When babies are born,
right,
and they find out that they're deaf, the doctor's first response very often is, oh, we need to make sure that they are able to function in the hearing world. They do not strongly encourage acquisition of sign language. They don't talk about that. They want them to be able to survive in a hearing world. So we struggle with the medical professionals. And often the parents don't have that exposure to deafness and that experience with deafness, and they rely on the professionals in the medical field. You know, we try to advise, we try to give the information about the resources that are available, but it always falls back on the people in the medical profession, and that is a constant challenge that we face.
Thanks for bringing this up, talking about the medical profession. Parents' normal reaction when they have a deaf baby is, or any baby, they want the baby to be like themselves. This is natural and normal for any parent. So now they have a deaf child. I want my child to be able to speak, is their thought. The doctor's telling me that I can do that, and they have to use hearing aids, get a cochlear implant, and then my child will be able to hear. That means they'll be able to talk with me. This is their dream. This is what they're wishing. And doctors, I've asked many of them myself, in your medical school of 4 years, how much education you get about deafness and language? And they say maybe 15 minutes in their entire medical school career.
Wow.
I mean, I'm lucky to have an hour with you because they only get 15 minutes.
Wow.
So their knowledge and understanding of language and the needs for deaf children is extremely limited. They see cochlear implants and hearing aids. They think that they'll help the child hear. That's the best way. The hearing aids and the cochlear implant companies, unfortunately, are promoting that the child must be immersed in an oral-only world. That's the only way they will learn. It's the only way they will thrive. But wait a minute. I mean, that would probably work if the parents are really, really involved and if they have the money to support the different resources, mapping for the implant,
yes,
speech therapy, et cetera.
Right.
It may happen. But for the world at large, it's not happening.
Right.
So we continue to encourage sign language and getting a linguistic foundation. And research in the last few years has proven that these are the successful people. So we have to change our approach. We need to be talking with the medical people. But this is a huge task in front of us.
Yes,
just huge.
Yes, it is.
But somebody has to do it. And I have people like Barbara and Sandy and many other people that will do it. But we need to educate people about why this is important. It has to be done.
Yeah.
And sign language research has proven that sign language will not in any way impede a child to learn to speak or hear. Signing actually supports the ability to speak and hear. So, and I'm not making this up.
That's
this
right.
is all based on research.
That's right. Well, listen, I want to get into the socializing part. I want to talk about, you know, how you party. You know, I want to talk about, you know, relationships. You know, there's a lot of questions I have. We have a video that I have we're going to show if we're ready for that. And, you know, because I always wanted to know about the music part of it, you know, your socializing part of it. And in my research, I stumbled across a lot of videos. There was a happy thing from Pharrell, the musician. But I found something that I thought was sweet. We want to go to that video. We ready for that video? I want to go to that video. And when we come back from the video, we're going to talk to you guys a little bit more. We're going to let our hair down a little bit. We're going to talk about you, the gentleman on Dancing with the Stars. You was on Channel 8 News. We're going to talk about that. We'll be back in a couple of seconds. So don't go away. If you didn't yet, call a friend. Tell them Keith Corlett show is on. We have a real hot topic on, very educational, informative. I appreciate you guys. We'll be back right after this.
Upon the ground. walk to school all by ourselves. There's dirt on our uniforms from chasing all the ants and worms. We clean up and now it's time to learn. We clean up and now it's time to learn. Numbers let us learn to spell. Nouns and books and show and tell. Playtime we will throw the ball. Back to class, through the hall. Teacher marks our height against the wall. Teacher marks our height against the wall. We don't notice any time pass. We don't notice anything. Sit side by side in every class. Teacher thinks that I sound funny, but she likes the way you sing. Tonight I'll dream while I'm in bed, when silly thoughts go through my head about the bugs and alphabet. When I wake tomorrow, I'll bet that you and I will walk together again. I can tell that we are gonna be friends.
You have to be able to respect the fact that it's not another world. It's a part of our world. But there's different ways of being. And if a person was blind, if a person had one leg, if a person couldn't hear, that doesn't mean that they're not a part of this world. Yes, culturally speaking, they have, you know, different cultures and different communities, but we are still one. People that are deaf still listen to music. People that are deaf still dance. They're probably some of the best partiers I know. I know one of my homeboys that is deaf that was at the Head Start program where I worked, and he was a single parent father. It didn't stop him from being a father. He still wanted to learn how to be a father. He was one of those guys that I worked with. I see him every now and then, and he gives me a big hug. He does sign language to me, and if I don't understand something, I tell him I don't understand what the hell he's saying. And what he'll do is he'll write it down or he'll let me know. So it shouldn't stop us. They're not different from us. They're just like us. We just communicate differently. My question is that I heard from a few people that, well, my statement is that a person who was deaf, the statement was, if I were to give you a pill that would allow you to hear right now for the rest of your life, would you take that pill? Most said no.
That's right.
Talk to me about that.
I mean, honestly, I don't know what it's like to be able to hear. I've never heard sound in my entire life, and I'm fine. I love my life. I'm married. I have 3 children. I'm an extremely happy guy. I travel the world. Why change me?
Yeah, I feel the same way as Jeff. Yeah, the same way. Why fix something that's not broken? I'm a very successful person. I was born deaf. My parents found out that I was deaf at the age of 3. They sent me to the American School for the Deaf. I graduated. I went to Gallaudet University, NYU, and I've been very successful in my job. So why would I want to start all over again? I'm very satisfied with who I am right now, and I'm very happy. I have everything that I need and want. Yeah, I was born hearing, and I became deaf at the age of 7. So you're talking about years it took to become, you know, to learn this experience, to be part of this culture, to be part of the deaf world, and to develop that sense of deaf pride. And I am proud to be deaf, and I wouldn't go back.
I don't mean to be racist or anything, but if I have a pill that you could take and you could become white, would you do it?
They asked me that question, too. You know, it's funny. They asked me that same question. I had a different answer, only because of economy and growing up and all the rest of that good old stuff. I'm proud of my heritage. I'm proud of my religion. If I think back now and I really keep it real, no, I wouldn't want to change who I am. But, and keeping it real, because I keep it real on the Keith Crawford Show, Would there be an advantage point if I wasn't African American? Keeping it real, it's a whole different subject, but would it be different? Probably. Would things wind up happening different to me, with me, for me? Probably. But in me being in this skin, and my brothers and my sisters, and growing up in the hood and everything else, I wouldn't change it. But I would say this right here. Would I want my children to grow up in a different world than what they grew up in? I would probably say yes, because I am African American. But because you are deaf, would you want your children to be born hearing? Or do you feel the exact same as you not hearing, that it's just as good, as good for you, as good for them? Just keeping it real, grassroots.
The same as you. If I could take a pill and become hearing, my world would probably be different. I probably would not be working in the field of education. I'd probably be a business guy earning millions of dollars. Those are things that could have happened, just like what you're talking about. But, you know, God created me as who I am, created you for who you are.
That's right.
Why change it? Why fix us, so
yeah,
to speak?
Yeah, I hear you.
I mean, there was a reason that we are who we are.
Yeah.
I married a hearing woman, even though my whole family is deaf. I married a woman that could hear.
You married a hearing woman. Now, Jeff. That would be considered a biracial relationship, correct? That would be considered, right?
Of sorts.
Right? There's a person that hears and a person that doesn't. And I didn't even think about this. And I tell you, Mary Good, she educated me a lot, as I'm looking up things as well. But that would be considered as an interracial relationship. Have you come across any problems? I mean, I'm just curious. Have you come across any problems with you hearing? And I mean, that's really weird to even think about it, but.
I broke the tradition in my family by marrying a hearing woman, four generations of deaf people, and then I married a hearing woman. It was all for love, no other reason. I found love in that woman. She's very, very special to me. My children can hear, all three of them. And I always say my wife's genes won over mine, unfortunately. But my children started to sign because I signed. They're all fluent signers, and they speak well as well. They're bilingual, really trilingual, because they're taking Spanish in school as well, so they're trilingual. They're awesome children, beautiful, and I've always been proud of them. I don't think it's about being deaf or hearing. It's about a relationship, a bond. My wife is always, you know, she gets mad at me sometimes because I can't hear. So we grow up with, you know, baby criers, and, you know, the babies are crying, the dog's barking, I sleep all night, she's awake. You know, I didn't know what happened. My wife's like, oh, I'm pulling my hair out, the baby's been crying all night long, and dog was barking all night long, and there's something outside, and you slept just like a little baby. It's like, okay, you go back to sleep, I'll take care of everything now, your turn to sleep. So those are the kind of funny things that happen with us.
And I want to add one more, and thank you for being so honest and straight up, I want to add one more little funny thing before we get to back to serious business. You seem like a really cool guy. So did you have like a cool rap with your sign language? I mean, how did you land? I mean, what was that about? You had to be a pretty cool guy when you did. I mean, how did you work that, man?
I used to wear a hearing aid when I was in school.
Okay.
Because it was normal to do so. Everybody wore hearing aids back then. Didn't really help me to hear anything or understand speech. It did not work for me. But I wore it until I went to the public high school. It was so much more noisy and loud than the school for the deaf. I took it off, and I have not used it since then.
But
I grew up with the hearing aids. My friends liked music. You know, I'd hang out with them like they did too. We'd dance. You know, we would sign songs. And our schools in those days would use us as kind of a show. You know, we could sign, people would be, oh, look at that. And then they would give money to the school because of our beautiful performances. Right. So we helped the school grow as well. But it was just part of us. I mean, I dance. I go to clubs with my wife. Actually, my wife and I take ballroom dancing every Tuesday night. We take classes. We have fun. We do. So really it depends on the individual. Not all hearing people dance. Not all hearing people are able to do that or want to do
That's right.
Same goes
with
deaf people.
That's right.
Yeah. When I was growing up, I wore hearing aids on both ears. And all of us did it. And it was more of a just being aware of environmental sounds. And with the music, we could feel the vibrations in your body. But I was not a shy person. I was very proud of using my hearing aids. And then I went to Gallaudet and NYU. And I got my job as a VR counselor. It was my first experience working with hearing people. Remember, I grew up at a deaf school. I went to a deaf university. And then I start working with hearing people. And I realized that when I would start to talk, because I could, they didn't really pay attention to me. They wouldn't give me eye contact. I took my hearing aids off and forced them to make eye contact with me so that I could communicate with them. So there's a lot of myths that we have to encounter. Mm-hmm. But it's nice to have the option to be able to take the hearing aid on and off. That's a nice option. However, you know, if you do have intelligible speech, hearing people will assume that you understand them and they will not make the effort to communicate with you face to face. And that is a true struggle for all of us in the deaf community.
Outstanding. Listen, I know we have just a little bit of time left for the show, so I don't want to miss this very important piece. I have an interpreter, and there's someone interpreting for the panel. Had the interpreter not been here, we wouldn't be able to do the show. So they're definitely an asset, a valuable. I mean, it wouldn't happen if they weren't here. Is there a shortage on interpreters? I mean, I know this funding's been cut, so that has to impact on that. I mean, what does that take? You know, and what is it? Certification? Is that, you know? I mean, how does it work with being an interpreter? And how valuable are they to this whole mission? If anyone wants to speak to that.
Oh, interpreters are our lifelines.
Right.
They really are to the hearing world. Yes, they provide that access to us, that visual access. There are not enough of them. And sometimes it's a hit or miss situation if you're going to get an interpreter or not. Also, there are not enough people who know how to get interpreting services. For example, if they're going to go to see a doctor or an attorney, you know, the attorneys and doctors don't know how to secure these services. Mm-hmm. And then they don't call, they don't, you know, check on that information, and when you get there, you don't have access. That's part of our daily life experience. You know, it's not like we have interpreters walking around with us everywhere we go.
Right.
That's not how it works.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we need to, when we go to that environment, there needs to be an interpreter provided. In Connecticut, our interpreters are required to be certified, and they must be registered with the state of Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
That's part of our state statute.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And right now, we have two interpreting agencies primarily. One is Life Bridges in Bridgeport, and the second is DORS, Department of Rehabilitation Services, the Deaf and Hard of Hearing Unit. So those are the two primary agencies that provide interpreting, and I would say, 50 interpreters total?
Wow.
No, well, DORS has 38.
38 for the entire state of Connecticut.
Wow.
Well, now that's 38 at DORS. Life Bridges has their own pool of interpreters, and I'm guessing maybe 45 maybe. But again, that's not enough. I want to go back to add to what Sandy just said. When we had the Commission on the Deaf and Hard of Hearing, it's now folded. It was established in 1974. We had a huge interpreter pool. We had about 78 interpreters on staff there. We had advocacy. We had case management. We had counselors. We had the job unit. They were truly our lifeline. They provided mentoring opportunities and for interpreters who wanted to become, you know, the trainees who wanted to become interpreters, but those positions have, you know, over the years been cut. And at one point, there was a large budget that the state allotted to the commission, and all of the courts and doctors and attorneys, whomever, just called and got an interpreter, and that was it, because the state paid for it.
Mm-hmm.
But when ADA, the Americans with Disabilities Act, was passed, it became an issue because now the responsibility for payment was on the attorney the doctor, the hospital, and the roles were reversed. And then it became a real challenge for us to get the interpreting services. I mean, before we didn't have a problem getting those interpreting services provided, but now that the individuals had to pay for those services, they said, oh, we don't really need them. And we started having to fight again to convince the attorneys, the interpreters, and all these, you know, it's you know, that we need this. The ADA was a wonderful thing, but it has provided a real hardship for many of the members of the deaf community.
If I can jump in real quick, we have like 4 minutes left on the show. So, man, I really appreciate this. Who are your supporters then? I mean, if funding's being cut or funding's not being, you're not getting this kind of assistance, I mean, what's going to happen? I mean, who are your supporters, you know, and how can we support?
I want to say something very briefly about interpreters. People need to know this. Interpreters are certified. They have to go through rigorous testing. And in the state of Connecticut, interpreters, like the two interpreters here, are certified. But the problem is in the public schools. They're utilizing people who are not certified interpreters. And I'm telling you, this is wrong. But they say, well, we have no other choice because we need someone to interpret. But who loses out? It's the child
that
loses out. And that needs to stop. It has to stop.
Exactly.
And it will stop.
And here is no child left behind. So we need to tap into that.
Thanks.
Have you guys been talking to superintendents and mayors here in New Haven and Hartford? Have you been talking to them?
It all boils down to money. And it's a battle. It's a true battle. And it's going to continue for not just us, but for all different
groups. But it's discrimination.
I want to say that the commission was our watchdog agency. And that has gone by the wayside. We are now, the three of us are the voice of the community. And again, it goes down to money, comes down to money.
So when you ask us to do the show, we were sure this is our opportunity to educate and to put this out there. And hopefully during the next legislative session, we'll be able to bring some of these issues and concerns to the legislature. They need to do something if they want to keep deaf people in the state of Connecticut. And in this fine state of Connecticut, we need to at least meet halfway.
Well, let's get a copy of this right here to the governor. Let's get a copy of this show to the governor. Okay.
That'd be great.
Now, I saw you on Dancing with the Stars. We're not going to be able to talk about it too much, but, you know, music, Dance with the Stars. How proud are you of this gentleman that's on Dancing with the Stars?
Oh. Niall. He just came out of the blue. It's funny. My wife taught Niall's brother when we lived in New York. So I have this little connection. I mean, the deaf community is small anyways, but I have that connection. When I saw him emerge, and I was like, whoa, look at this guy. He is our role model. He's a product of the School for the Deaf. He's...
Listen.
Yeah, and he comes from a deaf family.
Yeah,
exactly.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Yes, six generations.
Six generations. I bet you got a couple of moves too, huh? Yeah.
Okay. One day I'll show you a couple. For you, I would do that.
Listen, we're going to have to wrap the show up. We have a 200th anniversary coming up, correct? Right?
Yes.
When that happens, I want you on the show. I want to celebrate that with you on the show. Please. Have to have you on. I also want to say that I want you guys to tap into Citizens Television here in New Haven. Get your community together. Let some students... Let some families come down, take a class. Yeah, they might have to tweak some things, but you never know what's going to happen out of that. I would like to see you guys have a show on Citizens Television to reach out. Yeah, there might not be money for closed captions. That stuff costs money. But I bet you the more you start bringing stuff here, the more those grants and the funding might help out. I don't know. I know that we need to have a show for people that are deaf, people that are hard of hearing. It's not going to hurt. I think it's only going to help your advocacy. I don't know. What do I know? I'm just a bald guy doing this show. Jeff, I appreciate you coming on. Love you like a play, cousin.
Honestly, thank you for having this show because you're making a difference.
I appreciate you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
How do you do? I try to